Sayyidina, I have a question then about whenever people do things that seem to be for God's glory. For example, when Jesus was saying that some will say to him, "Didn't we cast out demons in your name?" And then God will tell them, "Well, depart from me because you practice lawlessness." But it would seem that it's something for God's glory. So how does one make sure that we don't fall into the lawlessness group?
Because there is discrepancy here between their life and their goal. If they are living for the glory of God, how they practice lawlessness. And here, you who practice lawlessness, all of us who have our own mistakes and our own sins. But the Lord means here, you are not living the life of repentance. Just you practice lawlessness and you continue to practice lawlessness without repenting. So this like hypocrisy, like the scribe and Pharisees, that the Lord rebuked them because of their hypocrisy. From outside, they want to say everything I'm doing for the glory of God. But in reality, they were not doing for the glory of God. They were doing it for their own glory, because their behavior and their life and what they practice does not match, does not go hand in hand with, their calling or their life.
Sayyidina, when we achieve success, we either can feel humble, this is how we're supposed to feel, or we can the devil can fight us with having pride of our success. Or if we deny our success too much, the devil can fight us with low self-worth. So how can we maintain this balance to feel in a positive way when we achieve success?
This is a very good point, usually because successful people are tempted most of the time with pride. And as you said, if I deny this, maybe I will suffer from low self-esteem. But I think here the balance comes from where this success came. My success is not from myself, because without God I cannot achieve anything. So the success is through the grace of God. It's not through my abilities. If God actually left me, I will fail. But it is God who gave me the spirit of prosperity, the spirit of success. So when I understand it is a gift from God, this will keep me humble. But in the same way, I'm not suffering from self-esteem, because I know Christ loves me. And because he loves me, he gave me these gifts and he gave me these talents and he made me successful. So I am aware of this success. I'm not denying. I'm not saying I'm a failure. No, I am aware that I am successful. But I know also that this success is not my own effort. It is from the grace of God. No. So, like St. Paul said, I can do all things in Jesus Christ who strengthens me. This is a statement of success. And it's not a statement of a person who has low self-esteem. I can do all things, but how can I do all things? In Christ who strengthens me. So I'm confident, not because I can do it, but because Christ strengthens me.
I think one for me would be Abu Sufyan Marcorius. He was very successful in the army. He was a high-ranked official, and yet he was very religious and he was very godly and he was a saint.
And he did not let this distract him from actually serving the Lord. And when the goals contradicted, he chose to shed his blood for Christ. He did not compromise his faith for the vain glory of the world. Yeah, that's a very, very good example for Patriarch Marcorius.
I think an obvious example is Joseph, of course, and because it's an example of not an earthly immediate success, but a God-given goal that he reached after a long struggle through the years, and that he maintained his faith through all the trials that he faced.
Exactly. And as you said, we learn from Joseph to be patient. Even if I didn't achieve success now, here and now, but I know eventually God will make me achieve this success. But I want also to say Joseph was not only successful because he became the second man of Egypt, but he was successful also in his spiritual life. You know, this struggle, he was a young man, and he was a slave in the house of Potiphar, and his master's wife tried to tempt him. So actually, all the circumstances working toward giving him an excuse to break the commandment of God. And by the way, at the time of Joseph, the law was not given to Moses because Joseph was before Moses. And if he actually listened to his master's wife, he wouldn't go to jail. But see here, that's actually the real success. He accepted to be in jail rather than to defile his purity. And he said, how can I commit this great wickedness and sin against the Lord? You know, and he chose to be thrown in prison rather than to break the command of God. So he was not only successful on the earthly standard, he became the second man of Egypt, but also on the spiritual level, he was victorious in his spiritual struggle against sin.
I think one of the good success stories in the Old Testament, how they came back and they rebuilt the city of God, and when they decided, as you said, Sayyidina, when they decided their goals and what we need to do is we need to build the house of the Lord before we build our own houses, and what we need to do first is do the, you know, the fence around the city, and they decided what their goals are, what they need to do, and the order they need to do these goals, and they were successful, and they did really good.
Certainly, I like the story of Nehemiah. Nehemiah, I believe he is a reformer. Actually, when you read the first chapter, everybody was hopeless, helpless. There is no any motivation, you know, and this is the beginning. So actually, he did not start from zero. He started from under zero. Everybody was hopelessness, you know, but how through the grace of God he was able actually to motivate everybody and to make a plan and to divide them into teams and to make sure the goals and long-term goals, you know, and you know, step by step they were able actually to build the wall of Jerusalem, to build the city, you know. Yes, Nehemiah is the best example of a reformer who started actually from under zero, like failure, and he was able actually to succeed for the glory of God. Yeah, thank you for this.
I have a question. Would you consider Ezekiel as a success with all the problems that he suffered, all the sufferings that he had to go through to deliver the images or the testimonies that God used him to deliver to the people at that hard time?
If we think that the road of success is paved with roses and flowers, we are deceiving ourselves. You know, the Lord said the gate is narrow and the way is difficult. So we should expect hardship, difficulties, you know, in the road to success. Joshua, son of Sirach, In chapter 2, verse 1, he says, my son, if you serve the Lord, prepare yourself for many hardships and many trials. You know, and suffering actually and hardship is part of how we build our character. You know, because in suffering and in hardship, our character will be stronger, you know, and actually will become better people. Usually people come out of the hardship, you know, stronger than before. So this is an essential part of success.
See, this makes me think of Moses, how it wasn't until he left all the glory of Egypt that then he became so humble. So.
Exactly. Moses actually, he tried to deliver the Israelites from Egypt by his own power at the beginning, but he failed. And after God disciplined him, and he actually fled for 40 years and learned how to be humble, then God sent him to deliver the Israelites from the land of Egypt. And the second time, he was successful. But the first time, he actually escaped. He ran away. Which there is a very important lesson for us here. When we trust our own abilities, actually, we will fail. But when we trust the grace of God, don't trust in our own abilities and wisdom and our understanding. But when we trust the Lord, actually, this is the road of success.
Sayyidina, I believe that all the martyrs and all the believers, any believer, deny himself and bear the cross and follow Jesus, he is a hero and he is so successful. So in the history of the church, there are so many successful saints, so many heroes. Ladies, girls, boys, men, if a mother can offer her children for the Lord and they see and she see them torture their kids, she is so successful woman, so successful, so she is a hero. So success is must for everybody whom we believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, because God gave us a victorious life. He gave us the life of victory, not the life of failure. So we as a Christians always should stand for the success. With the help of God, with the help of the Holy Spirit, we can overcome any problem we are facing. Thank you, Sayyidina, for being with us on that wonderful day. You educated us so much. We thank you for that. And thank all the wonderful youth who came today, attend that session. And we're looking forward to see you, your grace, and bless us with your word, with your education. And we wish to everybody a very successful life. See you once again later on. Thank you.